Greetings, folks. Flying Doctor here. Hope you're doing okay. It's been some time since my last broadcast. Almost sounds like a confession, doesn't it? But it's really good to be able to share with you again. Now, many of you will know that I'm a fan of the HPG Airbus H145 by Height Performance Group, and I've devoted a great deal of my channel thus far to tutorials and also reviews associated with how the Airbus performs. The one thing that I haven't covered is something called the Hype Operation Centre, and that's because up until now I've not really felt that the product's been at near a level of maturity. However, just cancel all the advice that I've given you before about how to update the HPG 145 manually when you're invited to do so. If you're interested in new proof of concept models, well, there's a balloon that you can take a look at here. If also you're interested in updating the software within the helicopter, the GTN 750, you can do that via the Hype Operation Centre. And most importantly, it's not my particular world, but other people really get a great deal from it. You're able to plan missions. So it's great to be with you, folks. Let's geek out. So, the Hype Operation Centre, what am I talking about? Well, if you buy the H145, Hype Performance have been really good within their emails thus far. I mean, obviously, I bought the helicopter some time ago, so I'm not quite clear on what the current emails say when you make a purchase, but they've always been excellent in the past of highlighting how you can download the helicopter in the first place. And also they highlight the fact that you can have this base pack, as you can see here, and then you can get the action pack. And also on the site here, I'm on hypeperformancegroup.com, you can see what I think has been a very successful proof of concept for HPG, a hot air balloon. But suffice to say, when you downloaded the helicopter in the oldie days, Hype Performance Group would email you, or you'd see a shout out on Discord as to how you could update it. Well, the Operation Centre has made that much easier, and also the Operation Centre just opens up a world of missions that you may well be interested in. And I'm just doing a straight walkthrough here. I haven't looked at this software in any great detail, but I did have a quick 3 minutes just flipped, and I thought this seems really intuitive, really easy to use. I'm just going to do something cold. So I noticed that the Hype Operation Centre is also available here on one of the tabs right at the top of the site, and I notice an informational here from that the H145 helicopter has been updated to take advantage of the new Asobo helicopter flight model. One of the things that's great about the helicopter is it's constantly being updated. If I click on the Hype Operation Centre, I get to this page and a simple download. You download that, execute the file, and it will sit as a separate program on your desktop. And when you open it out, this is what you'll get. Or rather, as I've journeyed with the software, this is what I've got on my screen, having done no update of the H145 recently. And I previously used to follow the Discord channel that would tell me, but been a bit busy on the run-up to Christmas and the new year. So what's changed here is previously I gave some very clear examples about how to update the helicopter manually by loading the updates to wherever you've stored the helicopter in the first place, whether it's in a community folder and you're linking to it, or whether it's directly whether it's on a separate folder, in a separate folder on a separate drive and you're linking to it, or when it's in the Microsoft community folder. It was quite a rigmarole, but I'm really encouraged here because I'm aware that this has improved. So let's just go through what we've got first. So I can see that the helicopter that I've got, as you set up the software, it invites you to input the key that you get from email, and then it will register your helicopter, and then it will also give you, you have an opportunity, I do believe, to manage the installation, you know, to say to Hype Performance Centre where the installation is. It's really, really straightforward. But let's have a look on the left here, and this is just how it's coming at me, although my eye's in the top middle at the moment because it says manage installation. I'll come to that later. But within the software, I can freely update the helicopter. I don't need to go anywhere else. There are other products that are on offer, the HPG hot air balloon and the HPG 135 freeware, which is well worth downloading. And also you can see here that there's an update available for the GTN 750. And there's a whole app update. So I'm really interested in this, and I will come to that later. We'll refresh the app and we'll come back to it later. We also see some tabs on the left here: mission editor, mission content, completed missions, hype radio, hype online, and settings. Here's perhaps one of the really important things: manage installation on the top here. If I click that, what happens? It tells me what the installed packages are. And the key code here, I'm not going to click on this for my base pack and action pack. It will have asked you to put that in before when you load the software up. And it's telling me precisely what versions that I've got available. And it's also, I can tell straight away, it's inviting me to install what looks like two newer versions, up to build 3.7.2. So yeah, immediately I'm kind of thinking that everything feels about it very easy. There's my user guide. I can click on that, view and modify. I'll tell you what I'm going to do first. I'm going to update the app and see what happens and see what's changed. And then I'll join you after I've done that. This looks fairly simple. I just clicked the update app, and there we go. It's downloading Hype Operations Center Setup X 103 megabytes. We'll see where we are at the end of this. And I have to confess, that was one of the smoothest update processes that I have ever seen. Didn't even have to touch a button, apart from firstly saying yes, update, and I'm back here. And so I've got latest version of the app I can see down here. And so let's just walk us through and let's just have a look and see where we are at. I noticed the user guides there, just a quick click. That's just a lot easier, to be honest. I kept my user guide on the desktop, but with a shortcut, but it's not always the case that it was easy to get to. If you sit this app on a separate monitor, easy to get to, just pops up in a separate window. And I can notice that there are, as I just flick through, I've noticed that there are some updates there. I can tell by the change in the graphics as well in certain sections. So yes, once you get the Hype Operations Center, such ease in terms of updating, as we'll see, not just the aircraft, but also everything that goes with it. So you've all got it in one place as well. Telling me what build I've got installed for the base pack and the action pack there. We'd looked at the managed installation before. I can't remember how when I set this up, but I think it basically asked me, you know, where was I, had I installed the H145, and I seem to think there wasn't a problem. I keep mine in my Microsoft Community folder, but plenty of other aircraft I keep outside and just do a simple link within. Both will work. Key bindings is interesting as we move across the light. I get a lot of questions in the videos about key bindings. I mean, I'm always willing, and it's lovely to share enthusiasm with people, but sometimes I feel like saying, yeah, the manual's there for a reason. If you read the manual, it's there, but it is quite a lot to get through, and sometimes it's quicker, isn't it, to ask for this, so I'm quite happy with that. But key bindings is a really interesting one, how the key bindings work. So if you click on View and Modify here, so what we've got is we have the specifics of the functions within the helicopter. For example, the button click, where you would be able to click on and click off GTC, or where you would be able to use the right beat trim, there it is down there, the left beat trim, up and down. And what it's saying is that if you want to program those buttons within Microsoft Flight Simulator, so for example, cyclic beat trim right, you would map aileron trim right. So when you go to Microsoft Flight Simulator, it's aileron trim right, and you map the button on your controller to this particular feature. And then when you click on the button, and Microsoft Flight Simulator reads aileron trim right, but from that high performance group aircraft reads cyclic beat trim right. So that's how that works. Probably worth adding as well, I think it's key that you can have additional key bindings there as well. For example, I want to be able to move my airspeed knob clockwise, and I can set that within Microsoft Flight Simulator to another feature, another command that is simply not used by the H145. For example, set ADF card. You don't use that within the H145 within Flight Simulator, so you may as well use it for something else. So I use the trigger for set ADF card within Microsoft Flight Simulator. I program that to one of the buttons on my controller, happens to be on a throttle stick, and that allows me to, it is a knob that turns, and it allows me to adjust the speed clockwise, and you can see that there. And I've made other ones to address the altitude to clockwise and anti-clockwise, and you can see the speed is anti-clockwise and clockwise. And so what you're doing is as you enter, say, ADF1 swap on my button on my throttle system, I am turning that button, the button I wish to program clockwise, as I am programming ADF1, and then anti-clockwise. And that way you're able to save particular buttons on your joystick having particular features. It's the kind of thing that you need to play around with, obviously, to find what's comfortable with you. Yes, it's great that we've got this feature to add additional custom key bindings. And there's an important note here. So key bindings are stored in the user setup. You don't have to go anywhere near there, but that's where they're stored. But for your custom key bindings to become valid, you need to restart Microsoft Flight Simulator so the user setup is loaded and the updated key bindings are in there. But it's really, really simple. So I want to, for example, change my heading clockwise. I go to the adjustable joystick knob on my controller, and if I want to turn clockwise, I've decided to, I'll add a binding for you. Okay, so there we go. I'll click on add binding. There we go. So I've got an option here on the left. So what do I want to add? Well, lots of options here when I click down there on not found. Let's have master battery up. Okay, which I don't think I've used anywhere else. Okay, and then what I do there is once I've worked out what command I want, I click on the left one here and it tells me the vacant commands that are available. I think these are the vacant commands that are available within Microsoft Flight Simulator. So we'll go toddle anti-skid brakes. There we go. I'm interested. So in other words, if I toggle that button or that switch on my joystick to toddle anti-skid brakes, so in other words, you call anti-skid brakes up in Microsoft Flight Simulator under the control section, and you program that with the battery you want, and the HP145 will read that as master battery up. Isn't that great? I'm going to delete it though, just to show how easy it is to delete. So yeah, that is how to make custom key changes. Remember your key bindings, and it's really helpful because otherwise I was printing out a sheet before. So excellent job there. We'll just cancel that and move on, shall we? So yeah, we've done base pack, action pack, key bindings, manage installation. We'll come to that later because these updates are available, and I think you can update them either there by managing your installation, or you can go direct to these buttons. I'm interested in what these buttons do. And then we've got indexed missions. And so I can't promise to know much about this at all. It's not really my kind of scenario that kind of switches me on. But plenty of people enjoy this, and if I had more time, perhaps I would. There are some set missions that are already planned that you access through the tablet when you're flying under the mission section. And I can update these. Let's click that and see what happens. I've not got any new things coming through. And my guess is it would tell me if I had new index missions to update. You can see them here. You can call up these particular missions. Keep a look on this because I think this is going to get interesting as we work our way through. Let's have a look at updating on our aircraft then. So I'm going to go on the left here and try this. So update available. Okay, it's not actually allowing me to click on that. And in a way, I like that because I think see some duality here, because I think it's within manage installation, not a problem. But it's saying you've got your update for H145 available, an update for a hot air balloon if you want it. There's some freeware out there, and there's some update here for the PMS. Now, the PMS 50 is different, and I will come to that later. But for the moment, let's look at the update that's available for the H145. So let's click on Manage Installation. And it's telling me my installed versions of the base pack and the action pack. As you can see, you'll have put it in your saved key code. If you haven't, you've got an opportunity to buy perhaps the action pack. And then it's telling me what available versions I have. And so I can update straight away to H145 beta. I've got a stable release down here. Show hidden versions. What does that do? All right, so you can actually install. So if you click on hidden versions, for example, now a lot of these are betas, but you can see the tremendous of amount of work that has been done here. So on the left-hand side, you can see what the updates are. On the right-hand side, you can see whether you've installed them. And I noticed that I'm down to actually, I did have a beta installed. It was H145 beta build 362. And then I kind of haven't updated it. And then there's been subsequent betas all the way up to here. And usually you reach a point where you get to a stable build. I'm not sure whether we're onto a stable build yet, but they're all betas. But you can see all of this, all of the detail here telling you exactly what the update involved. Now, this is, again, it's excellent word from Hype. I'm a great fan also of the Discord chat. Great folks over there in Discord. Hi to everyone. But suffice to say, keeping track of exactly what had been updated is a bit of a challenge. And here you are here, all of this hard work being done. So excellent. So I'm just going to try it now. I'm going to click on install and we'll see what happens. Okay, so there we are. It's downloading there. This is literally as it happens. I'm just going to pause it, just screen. And we haven't lost anything. It's just said finished success. I was expecting, because it was a zip file, I thought, oh, it might kind of throw out a zip file and I'll get a little window to say, oh, you've got to unzip the zip file and use the right program to do it, because I have to have two. But there you go. Easy as pie. It's installed. We're fully installed now. So that is excellent. So as I say, you can take back and shred my previous guidance on how to update. Because this is just absolutely fantastic work. And I'm probably late to the party here. I've not majored on this, but I did realize that functionality was coming. But there's plenty of new people who are buying the H145 and they might really appreciate this walkthrough. Okay, let's see what else we have got here. Well, if I click on HPG H135, I can't actually remember. I knew it was installed, but it's telling me that it is installed, it's seen it, it's got a user guide, and it's telling me I've got build 447. So there's nothing more to do there. But I'm going to click the user guide. And that is because, if you've seen my concerns over the Orbix software, these links that Orbix put out with the user guides, you know, they are complete, well, they're just, the links just aren't there. So it's really good to see a piece of software. I know it's not brain surgery going on here, but it's really good to see a piece of software where the links are there when you click them. So that's everything. So if I want to just explore a bit more about how to use the 135 freeware, it's there. So fantastic. Let's just have a look at the update available for the GTN 750, how that works. So I'm getting a definite update there. I've got an open the user guide, which is going to be straightforward. That's working. Excellent. So this is stopping me surfing around the net to find different sites. So, you know, I'd usually Google PMS 50 and then have a look. And it's got the installation instructions here. Now, I have a sneaking suspicion that you will still have to go over to the PMS 50 to manually update the unit. And also there's a premium unit with this as well, but the fact that there's a clear point to this and the functionality, just really interested to see here. So yes, it's got instructions on how to install and the different ways of doing that. So the installation instructions, yeah, just here. Get the GTN 750 package from PMS 50 site. Well, should we click on that and see what happens? Oh, yeah, that's alive. It's come up in a separate second window here. GTN 750 for Microsoft Flight Simulator 2020. And I happen to have the previous version, but I can download the latest version there. Current version is 2163. And we'll have a look and see what happens if we do that. Okay, I've got a save as. And I notice here that the file name is the same, but the bracket. So I'm going to have a look at saving this. And may well go to a new folder. I'm going to put one in here because I'm a bit cunning like that. And we'll just see. So we'll type in, it doesn't really matter, PMS50. I'm just putting it with a folder within the folder. I'm actually maintaining a bit of my privacy here. So we're going to save in there. There we go. It saves as a zip, as you can see. And then we will have a look there later, and I'll just come back shortly and I'll report back how that's gone. Although it's more about the PMS, about the GTN 750 and how their sort of update process works. Not necessarily to do with HPG, but let's have a look. Straightforward downloads there and unzipping. I've got my PMS 50 instrument GTN 750 folder, and I'm just going to copy and paste it. So this is my community folder. You can see here I've got a good number of folders here with an arrow next to it. That's because they are linked. I use add-ons linker, Microsoft Flight Simulator add-on linker. There are other programs that you can use as well, but add-on linker is free, works perfectly well for me. But there are also some there we are, that don't have a little arrow. That means they're seated there and that's where they live permanently. And they are, so that's in my community folder. Now I'm going to right click here and I'm just going to paste here. Now the reason I'm doing a right click paste is to try this first when you're updating the software. If you're copying over software one version to another, you might find if you're lucky and they've organized it well that your key code, because I pay for a premium version of the PMS 50, remains within the original folder, because you're kind of overwriting one with another, but the key code will remain. That'll mean that when you start up Microsoft Flight Simulator, you won't have to re-enter the code again, which is, it's not a problem to do, apart from it's just a bit of a faff, so I'm just going to paste there, and we'll see what we get to. There we are, and it's copy and cross. Replace the files in the destination, away we go. There we are. So that's relatively simple, straightforward. Made more straightforward. I did have to go across the site, but pretty much more straightforward because of the access straight away with a link with the PMS 50 site. Now, what I'm interested as I drop back here is if I stop and restart the software here, will the update notice for PM 50 disappear? Let's have a look. And yes, it does. Excellent. So High Performance Group, I'm really, really impressed with the ease at which you're able to get into this. Give me a lot of confidence straight away. And so let's just have a look. Now, we're into an area now. I have to confess, I don't really know what I'm doing because I haven't necessarily planned a lot of missions. Let's have a look and see what we've got here. So we've got a mission editor. So all I understand is that, well, I'm a little bit more than that because I know people fly them, that there are missions that are saved on the tablet that are already in situ where your helicopter is placed in a certain area and then you get an opportunity, to, for example, to do a medevac or fight a fire. And I've seen some of that software evolving and have had a little bit of a play before. But this is allowing you to plan missions, so we can plan a scenario. We'll come back to that later, shall we? Let's have a look at mission content. I think these are all the objects that you can draw from when you build your mission. So you build a scene that you're going to and a task that you need to do, and you incorporate that into the scene. So I can see that a flare can go up and different markers can go up there and different pilots can go down. You can place them on the ground, I assume. So there's a good number. Whoa, look at all of this. You can see all of these here. We can have a static fire. We can have the firefighting pool. We can have a car crash. So there are lots of objects here that I can draw from should I wish to in creating the mission content. Completed missions. Well, we haven't exactly done very well, have we? I have to be honest. I'm not really into this. Hype radio. Now, this is new to me. I think this is an area of the software that they are looking to develop. If anyone knows anything more, do shout in my direction. Hype Online seems to show what you've actually got. Whether these are flying missions, I don't know, but you can see helicopters here all the way around Europe. And I presume these are constant, these are flights at the moment in the H145, which is really interesting. I have to dig into that a little bit more. Settings, let's have a look at that. That's quite straightforward. The settings are where, that's important, I define my custom community folder location. If I click on that, it allows me to point to it. Okay, that's straightforward there. It shows me where the download cache is going to be, and it tells me where I clicked the Microsoft Store and the location of, I think it filled that in naturally when I started the software from scratch. But that's obviously registering whether you've got a Microsoft Store version of Flight Simulator or the Steam Store version. Okay, and a special use key is for special people, I suspect, who are playing about with this beta and developing it. So then let's have a look at Mission Editor. I really have had just a very brief play around with this just now, just to see how quickly it would flow, just and then come straight into recording, because I think again it seems really straightforward. So you can pick a number of new scenarios to design yourself for the civilian and VIP variants, for military operations, for HEMS, medical services, aerial firefighting, or offshore. And of course, that's the expansion of the variants that we're seeing now. And you just pick one of these plans. I thought it'd be nice to rescue someone from sea. We'll see how that happens, but I'm really interested in the planning side of things, so we're not actually going to do the mission. But offshore hoist rescue zones, that would be quite good. Fly to an accident scene and pick up the injured patient, then return that patient back to the destination, hopefully back to base. That'll do me. You can see it's got some little hints there. You can have a hoist or off-site landing with a custom rescue or street rescue. Bucket operations you can do with other players, so multiplayer compatible, and this is hoist only. So let's just plan this scenario, click on this. Now here we go, I am taken to the middle of Los Angeles here, which is not really what I want to be. The first thing I want to say is how usable this map is. I mean, other maps that I see produced in software really can have some lag about them, but this is very quick, very easy. It will tell me when I get to a point. Particularly if I switch over, you've got a satellite here as well, which is amazing. And I must admit that just the ease at which how we can surf around locations here is really easy. I mean, this is just fantastic, really fast, really free to use. And so I'm actually going to go to Iceland because, well, it's just one of my favourite destinations, really. And I'm going to go to Reykjavik, and I happen to know this part of the world a little bit, not a huge amount, but just enough. So we go to the airport there, and I've got a scenario that I think I'd like to plan, in that we'll take off from Reykjavik Airport, and we'll find somewhere that could well be a helipad start. I don't know how that'll work out when we actually end up in Flight Simulator. We'll have a scenario where we've got a sinking, and people needing evacuation to hospital really quickly, perhaps just outside the harbour here. And I'm not particularly interested in how true to life that might be, but we might do that. So we're going to take off from around about here, pick somebody up round here. And this is really kind of helpful because although I'm in satellite mode, it's so clear, isn't it? I'm thinking, where is the hospital? Would I flip through to map mode? I can see straight away on the map mode. There we go. There's a hospital there. So and I'll show this when we come to it later. So it means that I could pick somewhere to land where, according to the map, we have some space to be able to do that. Let's just drop out into the satellite plan anyway. I just like this. It's really crystal clear. It's obviously relying, I suspect, on Bing. I'm not sure what they're using here, but it's really good. But I found some buildings here, just here. You can see them. If I scale in too much, you can see the map data is not available. That's fair enough. But it seems to me, it says no accident zones. You must place at least one accident zone. No destination zones. These are on the right. You must place at least one destination zone. No start location. So let's just start then. So let's put a start location. If we click on the top here, start location. There we are. And I'm going to put a start location there. These buildings look small enough, suspiciously small, in fact, sat on a runway. Perhaps they might be able to hold take a helicopter. So there we go. There's a start destination. And so what else do I need to put in? And I can put in an end location or an accident zone or a destination zone. I don't know what the difference is with that, actually. I guess you could have a destination midway. I don't know. We'll just see. Anyway, I'm gonna come over to here, to the just outside the harbour wall here, and we're gonna put an accident zone in. I wonder what that is. And I wonder what destination zone is. So I need a destination zone and I need an accident zone. Oh, okay. So I'm flying into a destination zone, and then the accident might be, well, presumably on the same spot or something like that. Let's just see what happens. So we're going to put a destination zone in first. I don't know. And if I click on this and I drag, what happens? If I click let go and drag, I get a destination. And that's the destination zone is a rough area. Presumably I set that, and that's a radius there. I set that to signal when I'm reaching near the accident, and then I presume the accident zone, I've just clicked on accident zone, is smaller. So if we're dealing with a boat, let's just have a look. There we are. Let's just put, must be like that, really small. Let's zoom in. Okay, and then I can put some other objects in there. So if I click on other objects, it's great, you've got all of these objects going on here. And I thought, oh, where's the boats? Well, we'll put the boats down first. So we can put a life raft down there, right in the middle. We'll put a life raft in there because they're in trouble. But we've forgotten the sinking boat. There's two sinking boats. Perhaps we'll have a crash between two sinking boats. What about that? The boats have had a crash and there's a life raft there. Okay, so I've just put two boats in there. And I can actually orientate the heading. A sinking boat two, I don't know which is one and two. How do I see which is one and two? No, I can click the options here to show the icon on the cockpit map, but let's just try doing 90 degrees on one, see what happens. Does that actually register on the screen? It doesn't register on the screen, but one's headed 90 degrees to the other. I don't know, there could be still a mess. I don't know, so I can't do, and I can take one of the sinking boats off. Let's just have a look. Okay, and I can take the life raft off because the icons are the same. Okay, let's take that off. So the life raft. So we got a sinking boat there. So that's going at 90 degrees. So that's sailing away, isn't it? So if we do that one coming inwards, so that's going to be 270. Okay, and then we're going to put another a sinking boat one in as well. We'll put that on 90 as if they've had a collision. There we are, sinking boat one. It just means, I think, that you just, that's the style of boat, I reckon. It's a bit confusing. So you just have to keep track of what you're actually putting together here, but you're not putting a huge amount together. So we've got sinking boat. Then we put into it a life raft. Why not? Okay. And we're not having a car crash there. Oh, let's come out a little bit. So let's work out what else we could put on there. Presumably we need some people, don't we? I saw some really cool stuff. Oh, look, we could put a flare up. Should we put two flares up? Since we've got two boats, we'll put two flares up. How close can I go? Oh, I can put a flare right on that one. And with the flare, it's saying the object's heading. And it's got automatic smoke on the right here. So I put always orange smoke. That's right. And we'll have another flare here. Okay. And again, that can be orange smoke. So we should have two flares when we come up to it. It's interesting because we're not actually going to fly this at the moment. I will save it. I don't know what the civilians look like in how's this going to work in at sea. But we can have some waving civilians, can we? And we can have a couple injured. So I'll just put them really close onto the boat and just see what happens. We are a simulator. I put one there, one there. And because this is a rescue boat, no, I don't know if it is a rescue boat. It actually said it was a life raft, didn't it? But anyway, so we've got one there. We'll have somebody injured. How does that work? I don't know. How badly injured do they need to? An injured engineer has been engineered who's been injured. Let's have a look at that. So, okay. And so that's probably all we need there. Okay, what else do we need to do? So the radius is interesting here, that the radius of our accident zone is 30 metres and the destination zone is 134 metres. So I think it makes sense to me. You fly into that, it tells you you're in the zone and then you're looking around. But we should be practically on top of everything. Let's go on to select to move again, because I thought it might be nice to do something. So click across the map. It might be nice to do something. It's the first time it hasn't really shown me more than I would like to see. There we are. It's kind of woken up there. Bit of a delay, but still really quick. It wasn't. Didn't feel clunky whilst doing it. It feels very smooth. Now here I'm thinking, hang on a sec here. It'd be nice to land at a hospital, but I can't quite see a hospital. If I zoom in, I can find that there's something there. It looks like a hospital there, and I am going to think. Well, perhaps we'll land the helicopter here, because I don't know if there is a helipad. I don't know how you'd bring that in. So we're going to have a destination zone. And if I click on that, I don't really know what I'm doing. And if I click somewhere around here, I might be able to do it. But I'm actually going to click on the map because I'm interested to see. There we are. There we are. I'm interested to go somewhere around here. Land there, perhaps. Or land in this quadrant here, which might be ambitious. Because what I'm thinking is we could have an ambulance here transferring into hospital. So other objects, so we'll put an ambulance in. This is totally new to me. I've no idea what I'm doing. Right, where's the ambulance? No, down here, markers red, military tent, the plane crash, vehicles. Okay, we've got a ambulance there. Gosh, that was a bit obvious, wasn't it? It'd be a bit slow. So we'll stick an ambulance kind of just here. Presumably, that, you know, they'll need picking up. We'll also have a bit of a police presence on the road. If we've got a police car, city bus, fire truck, police car. All right, we'll put a police car in. Where am I going to put a police car? We'll put a police car just at... No, we don't want to stop people getting in, do we? Maybe put a bit of police presence somewhere here. Why not? Doesn't really matter. I'm just playing about. There we go. I think that's probably enough. So what's it saying that we've got here? We've got start location, no additional properties, destination zone, accident zone, destination zone, radius 11 meters, no data query. I'm not sure. Data query, find all, pick one. I've no idea what that means. What will happen if I do that? Oh, I see. Right, so no data, random point. If you click destination zone, find all, pick one, nearby helipads. Okay, and will it show me those? Oh, dear. If I click this, is it going to go crazy? Query in progress. Is this where the software is? So it's not found any helipads nearby to the hospital. I see. Nearby helipads all. Let's test that one. No, it's not find helipads there. So maybe it's because the helipads need to be within Microsoft Flight Simulator. I don't know, but that's an area that we worked on. I'd like to come back to that where I know that there are helipads. I'm quite surprised that there's no helipads in the area with it being Iceland. Nearby helipads. Oh, I'll try that again. We have tested it. Yeah. Okay. Well, there we are. And then we're going to go back to the airport once we've finished, because that's just nice. So it's going to be a very, very short flight, but we'll take it back to the airport and we need to find a different... Perhaps we land in a slightly different place. I'm trying to find my original area. There we go. There's the H for the original there. We will just come out and we will have our end location just here. Now it's a little... If I click on it, there's the end location there. So that should be, I think that's it. I think that's that. And I think I saved the changes. There we are. We'll save those. Export for Microsoft Flight Simulator. This does look fairly simple. Okay, so what do I have to do here? I've got to find somehow where that belongs. Okay, so this is new to me. When I click on Save Export for MS, M, MSFS. I thought perhaps it would come up with a flight plan or something. It hasn't. It's come up with a JSON file, a hype mission file, and it's opened up H145 firefighting server app 1030. Well, I'm going to remember that, but I'm just going to write down in there, because I'm not sure if I go to the tablet, will it automatically be there? So do we call it a mission or something? We call it Iceland Rescue. Iceland, and I'm going to put an underscore in there, Rescue. Okay, just so that we're all neat and smart and tidy, I'm going to save that. So we've saved a mission there, and I'm not quite sure what happens now, but we're going to zip back there. So we've planned a mission, and we're going to have a look. But that's effectively, I mean, I'll have a look at doing the mission and how I access it later. But yeah, that's the introduction to this whole software here, the Operation Centre. I hope you found it helpful. Do put some comments in the comment section. Really good to be able to share with you. It's been a while. But as I say, I think this piece of software has matured. And if I was looking at it earlier, it was a bit clinky. It's very, very smooth. And they get a lot of things right here. And the basic stuff, if you put a button saying open user guide, well, you know what I think about that. If you click on it, it's got to work. And really smooth, bringing things together in the same space. Excellent sort of process for updates, no glitches there whatsoever, and even PMS50 for the who kind of supply the GTN750 software. When I went onto that, because I got the kind of manual up on my desktop under the same, it was just pretty, it was much easier to do. So well done, High Performance Group. And I realize this might be a bit behind the curve, considering I think this was well before Christmas this was up and running. You might have been new to HPG, and I saw a lot of interest actually on the site. Presumably people have kind of maybe invested, treat themselves a bit over Christmas. So if you do like what you've seen, do subscribe. We're seeing kind of growth of interest in the H145 by HPG, but this is an excellent kind of an excellent platform for them. Take care, folks. Stay safe. I'll be with you. Keep an eye watching, because we're going to have a look at this mission. I can't help myself. I might have even caught the missions bug. There you go. Take care. Stay safe, folks.